Don't change the channel.
Don't you touch that channel.
Don't change the channel.
Dr. Maria will be preaching the gospel.
Don't change the channel.
Call your family and your friends.
Don't change the channel.
Shekinah's home right now. It begins.
With open faces,
we
behold his glory.
Change.
1 Samuel chapter 8, and I just want to read one verse there. As you know, we will exegese the text, so we're going to go through it. One verse, 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 7. Here beginneth the reading of God's holy word. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee. For they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. The word of the Lord for the people of God. You can take your seat. Today we go back to continue a series that I actually began at the beginning of August before I went on holiday. So we want to continue the series, Flawed Leaders. Flawed Leaders. I tell you. And we want to minister from the sermon topic, Family Flaws. Family Flaws. So right away, we want you to understand that leaders can be flawed. Okay, you're looking at one right now. We can miss it, but it's important that upon missing it, that we learn the lesson so that the new lesson of repentance and correction is now a part of the story. So let's deal with it. Again, we're talking about family flaws. Flawed leaders, flawed. Having a noticeable defect. There is obviously something wrong, and yet they are a leader. Church, I am convinced that one of the aims of the Bible, the Word of God, is to have you to respect leaders, however, worship God. There's a difference, you see. There are those leaders who will really have you to worship them. I want you to understand that we here at Shekinah Worship Center, I appreciate the respect, I appreciate the love, but the worship is only unto God. You see, look at this. God is flawless. All right. There is no disappointment or failure in God. Jesus, the earthly leader, was without blemish and worthy to be our sacrificial lamb. So while God is perfect and Jesus, the God-man, was perfect, we who lead are imperfect and yet daily striving to be perfected as we follow the example of Jesus, the Good Shepherd. The Bible is consistent with showing that leaders can and will go wrong, and that when leaders go wrong, God does not wink or walk away from the wrong. God brings the flaw to light so that you and I might learn from that leader what to do and what not to do. Oh, my God. Oh, yeah, whether that leader does right or wrong, you better learn what it is you ought to do and what you should not do. Now, listen, church. A flaw can be fixed if it is recognized. And if there is a desire to correct the flaw. I know we live in a time when everything is legitimized and there's a reason as to why you can do what you want to do. But I'm going to encourage you, church, as I encourage myself, that we would align ourselves according to the holy word of God and not the standard of mankind. And so we must fix the flaw. Because if not, the flaw can live on and on, becoming a generational curse. If the flaw is seen and any type of excuse is made in order to keep on doing the wrong thing. You know, my mama did that. My mama before did that. But my Lord, if it didn't work for grandmother and it messed up for mama, you know, just don't do it. disciple, it is incumbent upon God's leaders to follow the leading of God's Holy Spirit in making decision after decision. Here in the Old Testament, the leaders actually heard the voice of God, or they saw the presence of God appear as fire or smoky cloud, and they were responsible for doing as God instructed. Now, here today, we look at God's leader. We're going to look at it. And let me be clear and point out here that we will see in the text the importance of correction, even in leadership. Listen, if the devil cannot get the leader, watch it now, to commit outright sin or wrong, you know, missing the mark sin, the enemy of our soulish realm will work on that leader's children. Work on the leader by working on the offspring. Huh? The children of the leader. Can I get a witness that, listen, Pastor, you're not just talking about leaders, but I'm a parent, I'm a mother, I'm a stepmother, I'm a stepfather. And just because I want to do God's perfect will, it seems like the children, Lord have mercy. I know they're a blessing. I don't want to out my children, but my Lord. All right, up in here. I just want to know if I'm talking to real people, that's all. I tell you, they'll keep you on your knees if you let them. Lord Jesus. The enemy knows our heartbeat is our children. And therefore, when he cannot get to you, he will get to the children to get to you. Uh-huh. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Perhaps this is why. Yeah. In the New Testament, one of the written requirements of God's leaders is as follows. 1 Timothy 4, 3 and 4. He, talking about God's leader now, he must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him. And he must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. That's the NIV. In other words, God is saying to all the leaders, he's saying to all the leaders, listen, if you want to be a big shot in the church, you better be a big shot at home. If you want to tell the church people what to do, you better be telling your children what to do. Now, just like in church, not everybody's going to listen to the pastor. You know, at your house, not all the children listen to you. But I'm telling you something right now. You better know the order of God is that he looks at the leader. And that when he looks at the leader, he is looking to see if that leader is obeying his instructions. Mm-hmm. And so, listen, it does matter how a leader handles their family. It does matter that a leader does not allow their children to do holy things when their lives are not holy. Uh-huh. A title is more than a written word that gives power. A title in the kingdom is a position that allows you to be a surrogate for the standard of God. Every leader, come on, every leader, the moment that you accept your leadership position, you become a standard bearer. It doesn't matter what you're going through. If you're going, Deaconess Robin, you're going through sorrow. Well, you better handle it like a leader. It doesn't mean you won't sorrow, but it means that in everything, you'll still give thanks. And everything, you'll still honor God. Their tests and trials and tribulation, those storms. It doesn't matter. You still, I am a leader. I didn't promise God that I would serve him just during the good times. And even when the bad times come, God looked and said, that's a bad leader. God looks down upon his child and God says, that's my child. They know how to worship me. That worshiping me is not contingent upon what they're experiencing. They just know that they've been born to worship God. They've been born to worship God in spirit and in truth. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I'm going to bless him all the time, all the time. As a matter of fact, let me tell you how it goes. In case you don't know, I can pretty much tell you right now that everyone who's standing to their feet right now is going through some type of trial and tribulation, because usually the saint of God, when they're going through the most, is when they worship the most. I got to worship God. I got to worship my God out of this place. I got to worship out of this pit. I got to worship your God. Yeah. A real leader worships God out of what they're going through. Take your seat, people of God. That's right, no matter what. And so, let's look at the prophet Samuel, God's leader, and see why things went wrong as we look at the following 3 points. Point number one, appointed and anointed. Appointed and anointed. Point number two, appointed but not anointed. Appointed but not anointed. How about Jesus? And then point number three, appointment brings disappointment. Appointment brings disappointment. So let's deal with it. Point number one, appointed and anointed. Okay, who was appointed and anointed? Samuel was. Samuel, come on now. Please recall with me. This is little Samuel. Hannah's boy. The one that was in the temple. Huh? The one that was in the backside as we were of the temple being prepared. So don't miss it. Samuel is anointed. You know, I know we're going to look at what's going on here, but don't you forget that God himself timed the birth, the conception, and the birth of Samuel because he needed Samuel. So maybe God also needs for us leaders to understand that we need to catch ourselves sometimes, that we're going to miss it sometimes because God's anointed. Seems like I'm telling on myself, isn't it? And that's quite all right. You see, because we've got to learn it from the word. If not, we believe our own hype. We believe that we are invincible. Oh no. But for the blood of Jesus Christ, but for the precious blood of the Lamb of God, where would I be? What would I do? It's only because I trust in God. Come what may, because my anchor holds and grips the solid rock, that I can stand today and I can know in whom I believe, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto his hand against that day. Oh yeah. So we're talking about Samuel, ladies and gentlemen. Divinely chosen. Specifically chosen. Brought up literally in the house of God. Samuel knew God and knew God's presence from his youth. As Samuel grew in stature, the ephod, the holy linen, Lord have mercy, he wore was replaced because as he grew, the anointing grew. Can I tell you here, church? Here, catch this. That if you truly, and everybody going to be a leader in the house of God, let me tell you that right there. If you truly grow from month to month, from year to year in the house of God, that there is an anointing that comes upon you that's greater than what you had before. Now, let me tell you, by the Holy Ghost, God said this. Some people don't want the greater anointing so because it carries a weight, you see, and so you would rather stay at a low grade. But I'm here for the upgrade people today. I'm here for the people that said, hey, I'm going to keep on growing, Pastor. I'm going to keep on striving, Pastor. I know it's going to take some effort. I know it's going to take some time. And sometimes I'm going to have to cut my eyes to myself. But I'm going to keep on pushing. I'm going to keep on growing. I'm going to keep on making a statement that I am available for the upgrade. Do I have anybody available for the upgrade? God, take my life. God, use my life. God, do what you want to do. God, I submit myself. I submit my everything to you, God. Have your way with my life, God. Have your way. Oh, God. Don't be singing songs like I surrender all. All to Jesus. I surrender all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence. Daily live. Do you know what you're saying when you say that? Huh? You want to surrender all now? Means so in the job, the workplace, you're going to have to surrender your all. Huh? When they treat you right, when they don't treat you right, you're still surrendered, all of you. And so you're not your own. You've been bought with a price. This is the cost of leadership. This is the cost of dwelling in the house of God. Hallelujah. Samuel. There is no doubt, church, that Samuel, don't miss it, was anointed. Ain't no doubt about that. This is Samuel, who was so anointed that God had him to anoint his favorite son, David, to be king over all of Israel after Saul, another leader, went wrong. So let's put a pin in it right there to understand God's leaders always, they've always been going wrong. Ain't nothing new under the sun. It didn't start with the 1900s. Didn't start with the 2000s. God's leaders have always been going wrong. Now, Samuel, let's look at it. Recall that his name means God has heard. God has heard. So understand this. God has a specific purpose for hearing his leaders. When God hears his leaders, God is looking to hear his word echo out of the heart and mouth of his leaders. God doesn't make me a pastor so I can say what I want to say. God be like, that ain't get my word, Seaman. That doesn't line up not one little bit. Not one little bit. Everything that I administer, everything that I have written here, everything under the unction of the Spirit of God that I say has to line up with God's word. You see, Samuel was both a prophet and a judge. That's the way it went in the Old Testament. Samuel was a prophet, right? So he could speak in the house. And then when he stepped outside of the house, outside of the synagogue, he spoke over the land. He was a prophet and a judge. See, they don't want prophets and judges. They don't mind you prophesying right in that little, stay right down in your church, prophesy. You know, go in a hotel, have a prophetic conference. But don't come, see, listen. Oh, Lord, I think I'm back. Listen here. I'm trying to figure it out. Don't have a prophetic conference, and then you can't come out in public and speak what thus said the Lord to the land of Bermuda. What you got a prophetic conference for? To say you're going to meet a man? You're going to get a house and a car? Then you're going to help the island of Bermuda. The island of Bermuda needs us to cry aloud and spare not. Lift up our voice like a trumpet in Zion. Show God's people their transgressions and the house of Jacob, the house of Bermuda, their sin. I don't know what type of prophets they have today. Prophet liars, that's what a member said. I'm just repeating. So, Samuel was both a prophet and a judge. God, all the way in the Old Testament, sets up judges. Okay, let's do a basic question here. And you can all respond at the same time. What is it that judges do? They judge. So today you heard the famous quote, don't judge me, silly people. They judge the weather. They judge the friendship. They judge everything. What people don't want you to judge is the sin that they're committing, that so that you can actually expose it so that they can receive healing and deliverance. I'm telling you, God set up judges over the land. Oh, if we had judges in Bermuda that were set up by God and speaking as God would have, wouldn't be no case trying to legalize homosexuality. That wouldn't even make it in the courtroom. Let me go back to my notes. I'm doing good. So God sets up judges. Why? Because people, oh Lord, people are prone to wander. Come on now. People have a tendency to want to do things their own way. People have a tendency to want to make right what God called wrong. And so God appointed a specific voice in the land in order to keep the land straight. Wants the land straight, not crooked. Straight. All right. Samuel If you cannot keep your family doing right in God's house, this is trouble, Samuel. If your sons will not listen to you, they will hardly listen to me. Samuel, you are anointed and appointed. However, this does not automatically translate that your sons will also be anointed and appointed, or appointed and anointed. I mean, don't you wish it was a genetic tendency?
Yes.
You know, I'm glad. I heard you laughing, Alda. So, you know, when you push out the child, what? That immediately child is anointed with the Holy Ghost. Child ain't anointed with the Holy Ghost. Child has house all over the place. So I try to train them up. So get this now. Listen, this is a thoughtful something to ponder. If children cannot legitimately inherit sanctification, why do we give so much power to them inheriting those things that are not like God? We give that weight to the natural man. Let me read verse 1 here. And it came to pass, when Samuel was old, that he made his sons judges over Israel. Now please note, they were appointed, but not anointed. He made them. You got that? He made them. Made comes from the word shuam. Shuam. Appoint. Set up. Give. You know, what do they call it? Nepotism? That the one? That's the one? When you give your own relatives the job? Right here in the B-I-B-L-E. That's the book for me. I stand to learn on the word of God. The B-I-B. Right here, nepotism. Ain't nothing holy about them. I'm going to make them judge. Hey! They are judges, but they do not have the anointing of God over their lives to judge according to God. This means that whatever spirit, is upon them, you're right, oh Lord, is upon them, will be that which now is released upon the people. You wonder why things are in the congregation. You have to think about what was released from the pulpit. What spirit allowed it? Because you know pastors got eagle eyes. If I see anything looking bent, I'm going to deal with it. If I see anything that's feminine looking a bit harsh, I'm going to deal with it. Somehow we're going to deal with it. Because we are charged again with keeping the standard. Now let's look at these fellows, verse 2. Now the name of the firstborn was Joab, and the name of the second, Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba. God just keeps on telling you over and over. They are in charge, large and in charge. Let's look at the meaning of their name. Joab means Jehovah is God. Hesse. Abiah means Jehovah is my father. Church, you have the right name, and yet you're not walking according to the righteousness of your name. Now let me help you out here. Just because you are a Trimmingham or a Swan or a Dunkley or a Bean or a Seaman or whoever, this does not mean that you will automatically walk in a goodly, godly heritage. The title of leader does not automatically mean that you are leading the people in a godly way. Now, you know we're still waiting for the premier to decide what marriage is. It's like Obama. You started your reign and you said it was between a man and a woman. Obama switched up. Now we're waiting to hear what Dunkley thinks. Some people are like, we came to political church. You know, that's the other church around Court Street. I ain't saying nothing. I'm not applying for any, what they call, work permit? You would, but you wouldn't. Seaman ain't applying for no work permit. I'm going to work the works of him that sent me while it's day, for the nighttime cometh when no man can work. Oh, yeah. So understand, Samuel named them right, but they weren't right at all. How do you know if you are right? It is when you walk in the ways of God that You are right. So anytime I lead the girls against God, it is they who are wrong. God has never been wrong. God does not need to be corrected. How wrong did they go? Point number two. Appointed but not anointed. Verse 3. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre and took bribes and perverted judgment. Sounds like election time, doesn't it? They had the title, but did not carry the essence of the title. In essence, they were a walking lie in the house of God. Ooh. The scripture tells us that they, watch this, turned aside. They turned aside. Right there in verse 3. Comes from the word turned aside. Natah. To stretch or spread out, by implication to bend away, including moral deflection. Moral deflection. Serious, people. Serious. Church, when leaders encourage moral deflection or morally bending away from the plumb line of normality or turning away from the plumb line of God's set standard, such leaders are perverted. Yeah. I don't care if they're a millionaire, I said they're perverted. Yeah. I don't care how long they've been in leadership, I said that they are perverted. Yeah. Church, are you hearing me on this? Because we have to be accountable. Because when we say that we are a people after the word of God, then automatically, the moment that we turn aside from what we know, we have become perverted. The word of God is the plumb line. It is the standard. It is straight. And anything that bends away from straight is crooked. And it is perverted. Think about it, church. Samuel, the priest, he dressed a certain way. You know, imagine in your mind's eye. He dressed a certain way. When you saw Samuel, you immediately saw and respected Samuel for his dress and how he addressed manners. You know, I talk a little bit different than I do on a Sunday than I do on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, because I'm dressed on. You know, dresses on. You know, Pastor, dresses on. But when we put the rub on, oh, we're going to walk up to the standard. We're going to speak a certain way. We have just taken on the office of the title of that which we have proclaimed. Mm-hmm. So when you saw Samuel, you immediately respected Samuel for his dress. While clothes do not make the man, clothes are an indication of what the man is made of. Now, the lesson I'm going to give is going to be a bit exaggerated, but anyway, here we go. On one hand, you have Samuel dressed in a priestly robe. His private parts are covered. His loins are girded about with a belt. Samuel's tight. He's got it together. He's tight. This is the standard. He has the standard. He set the standard. It's the plumb line, right? Verse 3. Let's see if we think they're dressed the same way. And his sons, walked not in his ways. We don't want to walk like you did. But turned aside, got perverted. They're going to walk different. They turned aside after lucre and took bribes and perverted judgment. Yeah. We keep saying, come as you are. We keep on saying, come as you are. You church people, just let them come as you are. Well, if you wouldn't want your daughter with one of them dressed like that, why you think they're going to come in the house of God that way? And then tell me, my daughter can dress him, can date him no matter how he's dressed. I'll dress him up. Hello? You want to change how he's dressed? There is a standard, and the way that you dress speaks to your standard. Yes. It speaks to your standard. I'm going to tell you right now. They couldn't go in the army dressed like this. They couldn't go before the queen dressed like this. Yet on a Sunday or whatever day you worship, when we come before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we come any old way because we can do what we want to do. No, you can't. There's a standard. There's a plumb line. I don't know about you, but I don't want this type of dress person preaching behind the holy place. This does not represent holiness. Their loins, their private parts are not girded about. There's no need for a belt. You don't see what the devil is doing? What he is doing, and yeah, you're going to look at me that way, and I'm still going to preach it. I dealt with a young man. Hey, Seema, how you doing? And I got my car. I said, buy your pants down. He said, yeah. How are you going to represent anything? How are you going to demonstrate before your seed how to dress, how to have dignity? See, what we're having here, and this is what happened in Samuel's day, and so I'm going to deal with it. We automatically cancel ourselves out of certain positions by the disposition and by the way that we dress. If you're coming for a job, I'm going to tell it like it is. I'm going to put three people before you. If you're going for a job, you're dressed like this. If you go for a job, you got these guys. You got a black guy who has a suit on. And you got a white guy who has a suit on. Well, I'm telling you, who ain't getting a job? None of these two. And we have got to stop empowering our young black men to do what they want. No, you don't get. Put the camera right on me at this point. Young black males in Bermuda, you do not get to do what you want. Too many people fought. Too many people were attacked by dogs. Too many people hung from a tree and were lynched for you to talk about you want to do what you want to do. Get yourself a standard. Dress like a man. Walk like a man. Talk like a man. Martin Luther King didn't walk for this. Jesse Jackson ain't talking for this. That's why you'll see my little boys coming in and they got the suits on and pass that steam to, because we're training them to be leaders, training them how to walk, training them. I'm not going to let this world, I'm not going to let Bermuda, because you know what? Guess what? This pastor believes that black lives do matter. And so now, you will understand the struggle. Here it is. You all sit down. I'm going to show you something here. They don't mind you dressing down. Because they're after the leadership in you. Samuel's sons should have been walking like him. They should have been dressed like him. Yet, they went their own way. So rather than being tight, they were slack. Don't know the history behind what they're wearing. Being somebody's slave. Take up a book, read. They walk differently. They have a different standard of living. You know, let me drop this here. Let me drop this. Mamas, we gotta stop watching our males walk out of the house like this. They're sending a message. They're sending a message. Somebody gonna say, "Yeah, we should be able to dress any way we want. You're talking crazy. You're talking crazy. We have to set up a standard." No, look at this. Imagine this is Joab and Abiah. They're dressed differently. They have a different standard. If you are dressed differently, you can't hold up the standard of your foreparents. Okay, watch it. They have purposely gone after money. They have no problem being bought off, bribed. They have no problem in their office of being a judge. See, because I'm trying to figure out, as I drive around Bermuda, how non-working black males keep on being, looking healthy. How about you? Got you on sneakers. I'm got on $5.99 flip-flops. I got on $120 shoes. Let me tell you something. The enemy spirit knows you got leadership in you. Trust that. You got leadership in you. But what they must do is sink the ship. And so people will literally hire you as a foot soldier, as a lookout person. Because I'd be like driving, I'm getting like, but if they can be up at 7 o'clock in the morning looking down the corner, down the street, how come they can't make an 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock job? Stop being pimped by them. They're trying to destroy the potential that you have. Samuel, I'm going to bring you back. Samuel's sons walked differently. And this is the key. They carried the gavel in their hand. They were the judges. Whereas their father Samuel had a certain standard, a certain attitude when he judged the land because he didn't correct his sons. But you know, it was the right thing to pass on your heritage from yourself to your sons. You gave the gavel, you gave the judgment authority to your sons who didn't even obey you. And so automatically, come on, hear me, Bermuda, automatically the standard of the whole land becomes lowered. And so now it began with the boys sharing their body parts. Now the girls are sharing their body parts. I'm going to hurt somebody right here. When I see a girl dressed like that, you think I think she's in a Miss Bermuda pageant? No, she's usually going somewhere else. She's now looking for, man dressed like man, women dressed like women. Because the young children are watching. Samuel gives authority to his sons who are perverted to monitor the land. When you have perverted leaders, you have leaders who, like Attorney General, is that your Pettengill, Mr. Pettengill's Alice currently? Yeah. Want to come against the church? He better be thankful we're praying for him. Opening your mouth up against the God's holy word. Those people, you people, and talk about pray and hallelujah, Jerry. Lord have mercy. The man's got a gavel in his hand, and God ain't called him to be a judge. Making decisions that go against God. Now let me say this. What is worse is that now in this day and age, we have plenty of well-dressed, I'm going to go there, lawyers and judges who have no problem perverting judgment. When you walk out of God's way, you are perverted. Thank you, gentlemen. Now, I'm calling you a gentleman. Go and dress like one and come back into the service. Looking retarded. I mean, our Deacon Sumner, he would never have gotten that fireman job dressed like that. You know, because I'm going to be talking about it. This, you know, I put up a comment on Facebook this week. Nobody answering me because my vote is important to me. My question is, does the PLP believe in legalizing ganja? I tag Mark Bean. I tag somebody else, David Burke. I guess I'm invisible. I must be a ghost. I'm telling you right now, why will we as a black people legalize a drug? Not everybody got asthma and told about I got cancer and need to be taking weed something. They be smoking and messing up on their family life and duties. Don't be so quick to want to cover your own people that you end up destroying generations to come. I'm still waiting on a response. Because my vote is not for sale and it's not to be pimped. Right now, I don't like none of you. No. Put that there. Now, back to the text. So look at this, church. If all this perversion, everybody say perversion. If all this occurred in the very sanctuary, imagine what's going on outside of what should be the holy place. What challenged in the church? A lot of people ain't gonna be able to handle semen. Semen going in. I'm telling you right now, I've got eagle eyes. I go in, if I see a man, he looks twisted to me, I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. You better walk straight. I know it's right. Sounding cute. Curling his eyes more than me. That's going to be an issue. Oh, Lord Jesus. See, look. They are appointed, but there's no godly anointment upon their lives. Therefore, what should be being the house of God is quickly becoming a den of thieves and a den of liars. Because they were being bribed. Don't forget that. The Bible says they were going off the money. So listen, if I preach differently, if I say back off, Simon, back off, don't be too harsh enough because the people began already doing, the money's going with them. You know, so just ease up, man. Just preach about Daniel and the lion's den. Just preach about Noah, man. Noah made it through the flood. Just talk about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they didn't bam, bow, and or burn. Just stay there. Don't talk about nothing else because the money's got to stay in. You would, but you wouldn't. You might as well take your pocketbook, your wallet, everything right now. Escape, because I'm going to preach the word of God unrestrained. I'm going to preach what's right because I want us to make heaven. We've got to make heaven our home. We've got to understand that there is a standard that we must live by. If not, when we die, we will not see God. I want to see him. Oh, I want to see him. Look upon his face. There to sing forever of his saving grace. On the word, let me lift my voice. Tears all past. Home at last. Ever to rejoice. I'm making my way to heaven. I don't know about you, but this earth is not my final resting place. I'm a pilgrim traveling through. I'm going to heaven. I'm going to make heaven my home, and I'm going to do it through the correction and direction of the word of God. Hallelujah. And so, you know, the spirit, this happened to priests. The priests work. Samuel. The spirit of bribery. You know, I let that deacons do wrong. They put $100 in every week. I'm messing with them. I'll leave that out of line. That out always blesses me. A little something extra. Give me some gas money for the week. I'm not going to touch the sin. Bribery. Calling wrong right. Leading the people of God astray. In a place that should be sanctified. Do you people understand that the sanctified place is the place of the Shekinah or the Shekinah? It's the place where God looks to dwell, inhabit that place. Why is this important? When God dwells in that place, there is healing for your soul, for your body. There's a remedy for something you're going through that no doctor could provide. There's a peace and a comfort that you receive in the holy, sanctified place, the separated place. And so here we have Joel and Abiah. They are the judges. Woo, they are the judges. And so I call that episode, of course, it makes all the sense in the world to me. Why not? Judge Gate. Judge Gate, got every other type of gate, Jack Gate, Airport Gate now, Commissioner Inquiry Gate. We got more gates than I can name them in Bermuda. Judge Gate, who is judging God's house? And in the Old Testament, it is the very same thing as who is judge over the land. Bermuda's in a confused place because churches are confused. Some churches saying, I got to go back to it. You know, marriages between a man and a woman. Some churches say, oh, no. God just loves it when two men get together. Oh, no, God, I felt God. What did he say? Well, I'll never forget that man. You know, I just felt God's presence. And the walls of the church didn't come down. The physical walls didn't come down. But I tell you what, God ain't getting that place. The house of God here in Samuel's day is in trouble. The land is in trouble for. Verse 4, then the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah. His sons are in the church, running the church. Samuel and Ramah at this point. Hey, let's look at this. The elders. Those who know God. I expect my elders to know God. I expect the deacons to know God. I expect the leaders of Shekinah Worship Center to know when God's presence is moving heavily in the house and to become a part of that wonderful atmosphere, because somebody's going to get saved, healed, or delivered in that atmosphere. The elders, those who know God and those who understand the importance of obeying God, they unite. You see, the elders unite. Don't look for the two sons to unite. They need the older people. God, we got it together. They unite and they call a meeting with Samuel at Ramah. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. Ramah means hill. That's it. Hill. Don't miss it, though, church. Let's move from the low standard and meet in the high place. Lord, have mercy. Every Sunday, I want to meet in the high place. Every Sunday, I want to meet at Ramah. Every Sunday, no matter what we've experienced through the week, somebody ought to say, I'm looking for a high time in God's house this weekend. Every Sunday, we ought to have a passion to go up to the house of God, to mount, as it were, the holy place. Rhema. So let's go up and talk about what should be going on in the nation. Samuel, let's meet up the hill. Point three. Appointments bring disappointment. Mercy. Verse 5. Oh, gosh. And said unto him, behold, thou art old. Yeah. And thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. Get the picture. Right now, the sons are fully in charge, and they are wrecking the house. They are wreaking havoc. They are permitting things to go on that bring a disgrace to the name of God. These leaders recognize that Samuel has done nothing to correct his flawed family. See, that's the thing right there. Family is work. You know, you go sleep, and you say, when I wake up, like, everything is going to be okay. Anything. You have to keep on working with family. That's why God, but you know, that's beautiful, you know, because that's why God gives you this unusual love for your children. Because if not, you might lynch them yourselves. You know, so it's like you fall in love with them in the womb. God's wise, you know. I'm just admiring God. Can I admire God's work in a minute? I see a plan now, God. I mean, a woman. Miss that first period, you know. She's already forming thoughts. Now, maybe. She's already going. She's going way down the street. 2 weeks, way down the street. Ain't enough hormones in the body to even detect. Way down the street. Then she just finds out she's pregnant. Oh, my gosh. She's already got visions. What the child going to look like? Wonder if you have his hide. Wonder if she'll have better. Yeah. You, mama, already fallen in love. That's God's plan. Because if you don't fall in love with the child real hard, you're going to kill it at some point. And mother at some point said, like, let me go back to the hospital and see if I got the right bed. Like, something was missing in the translation around here. And so Samuel is old. Children not working right. The leaders recognize that Samuel has done nothing to correct his flawed family. That's it. You have to keep on trying. Mothers, fathers, you're not allowed to give up. I want you to know that. I want you to know that. I don't care what they go through, what they go to. Your name is Mama and Daddy, and that means they carry half of you. And if you can't give up on you, then you can't give up on your children. That's how it is. Hence now, they have a mistrust in who should lead them. The elders. Therefore, when godly leaders fail to lead people to God, those who need to be led will turn and look towards another nation for leadership. Oh, man, oh, man, oh, man. What if 2 years ago, man, what that fella named? Brandon. Tenney. What if Tenney Brandon came up to government? Whoever, who's the leader then? I don't know which premier. Was it Cannoner? Was it Dunkley? Whoever. Probably Dunkley. I don't know. Cannoner were in that long. Anyway, you know, so what if whoever was in Dunkley, they said, Tenney came to him. He said, you can present all you want. I present to you the gospel according to the living God. Squash that thing down. Say, you come the leader of this country. Don't bring it back to me. What? I might be able. I might be voting OBA right now. I would have said, my man, yes, sir. That's it, but no, anyway. Because the prophet Samuel, who knew God, Samuel knows God, did not correct his own sons, the people now desire to trade in the leadership of God for a king. You know, why are we following America? Because you do know that June 23rd, 2016 vote was in alignment with the June 23rd, 2015 Supreme Court decision. Why are we following America? They got Trump and Clinton. Why are we following America? Can somebody tell me why we're following America? I'm going to America. I'm going to Walmart. I'm going to Walmart. But when the people, here it is, are not focused on God, when the God's leaders as a whole, that means every denomination, black, white, every denomination, when the leaders as a whole are not lining up according to God's word, then the people get distracted. What they doing? What Canada doing? What Europe doing? I like islands where the leader says, Kenya did that. Come over here, President Obama. Let me tell you something. We may be killing people and whatnot, but it's going to be a man and a woman around here. It's going to be a man and a woman. Oh, we don't get it, do we? Mm-hmm. They desired a king and not God's supreme earthly representative. This is next verse here, 6, very interesting. But the thing displeased Samuel. Oh, you're displeased because they don't want you to be the leader anymore. But with your sons doing all types of stuff in the church, you didn't say anything. So apparently you're old, but you're not too old to get displeased. You see that? God carved him out from his youth. But because he didn't correct his youth, he now becomes a part of what's going on. So it says, but the thing displeased Samuel when they said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. Now see that but? Right at the beginning, but Samuel canceled out what they said. So he didn't even hear him. You know, Samuel, your son's a mess. But I don't like what you're saying. Yeah, but I'm telling you the truth. I don't like what you're saying. Okay. I guess that's supposed to stop everything. Samuel canceled out what they said. He rejected what the elders of Israel had to say to him. Yet here is what I really like. Samuel went back, to doing what he was raised in the temple to do. He prayed to God. Now, his motive for praying wasn't the same one as when his youth. Because this time, he's looking for God to say, how dare my people desire a king? They must stay under the prophet. God, sometimes God will give you just what you ask. He will release himself. Say, go ahead. Your heart had its sight. You know you ain't supposed to. Go ahead. Do what you want to do. I'll sit back. I'll catch you down the road. After the consequences fall out. Verse 7. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. I was thinking on that. God said, Maria, if they had sought me, check this out, Janice, if they had sought me and had sought my face, I would have raised up another godly leader. I would have replaced Samuel and his sons with a godly leader, because that's what I did with Samuel. But because their heart's desire is not me, and they even got their elders speaking against me for what the people want, so the elders, rather than correcting the people, want to come and give suggestions to the leader. Well, guess what? They haven't rejected you, Samuel, so get over yourself. They've actually rejected godly leadership and God himself. Important here, God reminds Samuel that he is thinking personal. That's a challenge right there. Leaders think personal. God wants you not to think personal, but purposeful. Samuel is not about you. Let me explain this. As your godly leader, if I went wrong, it should not be a valid option for you now to go wrong. As a matter of fact, that's when you ought to do just what was done. All the elders should get together, call a meeting, and put the pastor in her place. I'm telling you, because that's Bible. When the leader goes wrong, those that they, in this case, she has entrusted with a level of responsibility should get together and then meet up with the pastor. Yeah, right, I'm listening to God. You ain't coming after me. They have rejected God's divine order of leadership. They trust more in kings and lawyers and magistrates. You know, soon as somebody mentions QC, everybody's like, a QC, they cost money. And if they're going against God's word, they're still wrong. Oh, that's a lawyer. Oh. And let them, they can't stand up against God's word. I want you to find it in God's word, what he permits and what he doesn't. You find it in God's word, then you show me. I don't want to know your bylaws. No, I don't want to know all that. Go into the Bible. See that? Stop making man's law your standard. It's God's word that is the standard. Now look. They want a king. They want, watch this, a business person over the holy person. They want the America's cup over the bitter cup, the holy cup. Look, I'm going to put some news for you, Bermuda. I've got some news for you here. The America's cup ain't going to save your soul. Ain't going to pay your mortgage. Ain't going to pay your rent. But I'm telling you, there is a bitter cup. I know you said, Pastor, why call it bitter? Because it is bitter. It's bitter, but it's best. It's bitter. It'll make you. It'll cause you to trust God in situations and circumstances that are untrustable. It'll cause you to set your affection and set your attention to those things that are heavenly. We got too many that they want the flowery bed of ease. Oh, when I come to being a Christian, everything's supposed to be okay now. Everything's supposed to be easy. What? You're a soldier of the cross. You're in battle. You have a standard. You have now taken up your cross, and now you cannot let it down as you fight the good fight of faith. It's not easy. Not easy. So, yeah, Samuel missed it. Missed it with his sons. But note that God is still, ain't that wonderful, still speaking to Samuel. God knows how to deal with his leaders. You follow the leader as they follow God. The risk factor was that Samuel is old and the people did not trust that God will raise up another good leader. So they wanted a king. So right there, they slapped God in his face. So they said, we got the answer for you, God. Since you're messing up in your house, since Samuel and his sons are messed up, God, we got you. We know what we want. Oh, really? A king, a president, a prime minister, a premier will mess you up as they encourage you to rebel against the word of God. I think I want to repeat that. A king, a president.
That's all we have time for today. For a copy of this message in its entirety, please visit our church website at www.swim-international.com. Blessings abound.